Who doesn't love a good wagon? And this Volvo V90 Cross Country is a bit of a masterpiece. It's designed by the Scandinavians for Scandinavia, and it's a bit of a stunner, don't you think? But it's more than that. It'll outdo a lot of crossovers and SUVs, but it's also endangered as Volvo moves to EVs. What's it like? Buckle up and let's go for a drive.
I'm your host, Brian Max Racer, lover of driving fast, fun things. And on this channel, you get reviews for drivers from drivers. Yes, Volvo is transitioning to EVs, and this is probably the last V90 Cross Country in the way we've come to know it, with internal combustion engine under the hood. And before we get into what this is like to drive, let's have a look at it in a little more depth.
This V90 Cross Country uses a drivetrain recipe that we've seen before in other Volvos in this part of the world. It still uses that 2-liter supercharged and turbocharged 4-cylinder. I have to mention that it's also a mild hybrid with an integrated starter generator. It makes 295 horsepower at 5,700 RPM and 310 pounds of torque from 2,200 to 5,400 RPM. The transmission's an 8-speed automatic. The all-wheel drive system is the electronically controlled type. Electric power steering, of course, double wishbones at the front, Volvo signature integral link rear. There are available adaptive dampers with the air suspension option, which this one does have. 6 piston calipers at the front with 14.6 inch rotors, 2 piston calipers at the rear. Wheels and tires are 20s or 21s. This one is rocking the optional 21s. Towing capacity is about 2,000 pounds, and curb weight of this Volvo V90 Cross Country is a little shy of 4,300 pounds. Did you know that about 80% of you are not subscribed? Yes, it's true. I checked the data and 80% of you are not subscribed. So if you enjoy the content on this channel, do me a solid, hit that subscribe button. While you're at it, be sure to like this video and share it. And if you don't mind, drop by our merch store. There's lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Now back to your regularly scheduled episode.
The cockpit starts with this seat, and if anything, Volvo is known for their seats. I suppose it starts with their safety first ethos that they've had for years, and one of the things that they've done for years is ensured that the seats are safe, let alone the rest of the systems, like 3-point seat belts, and of course now airbags and crumple zones and all of that stuff. But fundamentally, their seats are also safe, but they are exceptionally comfortable and exceptionally supportive. Lots of adjustability, and they're positioned well inside the car so that I've got a great relationship to the steering wheel and to the pedals. There's a decent amount of adjustment in the steering column. The steering wheel is the right shape, the right size. My hands are encouraged to be at 9 and 3. Feels great, just the right shape. Love it. And on top of that, you've got great visibility right here. No trouble seeing out any of the windows. And of course, there are big mirrors, big outboard mirrors, so you can see what is in your blind spots with these things. It's just absolutely fantastic. And also in terms of visibility, there are cameras on this thing, so that helps with parking as well. Ergonomically, this is very Volvo, with Volvo's style imbued in all of the ergonomics. So the secondary controls here on the steering wheel, as well as the controls for the adaptive cruise control, they're very distinctive and different from what other manufacturers offer. While the infotainment system does work on Apple CarPlay, and I suppose it has Android Auto if you have one of those things, but it is very Google first. As we've covered in previous episodes, there's a lot going on here. So you've got live Google Maps and Google Assistant, and I do find that the Google Maps works wonderfully. When you're stopped, of course, you can play YouTube, which we're not going to do in this episode because this episode is all about driving. Because this is Volvo's biggest wagon, it's incredibly spacious, both here in the front row as well as in the second row and under the hatch. There's tons of cargo carrying capacity just on the inside of this V90 Cross Country, let alone what you can put on the roof. It would be bad form if I did not talk about the design. Yes, both inside and out, I'm still struck by how stunning these modern Volvos are. They're just stunning in every way. And that has to do with Volvo's Scandinavian heritage. Inside, this is one of the best interiors, complements some of the best seats in the business, but this is a stunning interior. It's aesthetically pleasing, and it just works even in late 2023 as we move into 2024. This is just a stunning automotive interior. This being a V90, especially a cross-country V90, it's not really that sporting, but it is quick enough in a straight line, 0-60 in 6.5 seconds or thereabouts. And that's appropriate, certainly for the price point of this V90 Cross Country. And it is quick enough to get out of its own way, out accelerate some other vehicles if you need to do that, accelerate up to highway speeds and maybe beyond if you so desire. Speaking of which, top speed is electronically limited to about 112 miles an hour, so you're not going to go that fast anyway. But yeah, the way the engine delivers power and torque with both the supercharger and the turbo is incredible. It is seamless, and power and torque delivery is incredibly smooth from the low end of the rev range to the upper end of the rev range. It's incredible how they've done it. The intention behind this particular power unit was that it was always going to be a hybrid, and here it is a mild hybrid. And given that it is a mild hybrid with that integrated starter generator, it stops and starts so smoothly. The only thing I will complain about with respect to this engine is that you do get a little bit of that four-cylinder noise inside the cabin from time to time. That's not very premium, that's not very Scandinavian, but in terms of the way the engine delivers power and torque, that is absolutely on point. I didn't get to try this all-wheel drive system in anything except a little bit of light rain, so not much to tell there. In terms of accelerating in a straight line, it seems to have no problem putting down all of the power and torque through the all-wheel drive system, at least in a straight line. As for the transmission, it shifts smoothly. There is not a sport mode. There are no drive modes in this V90, even though it does have the adaptive dampers with the air springs. And what I'd like is a sport mode, because your only option is to put this in manual, and then you can control the gearbox by moving the Orifor crystal shifter laterally. And that does work. If you need to, I tend to put it simply in drive and not worry about it, because that engine is very flexible and the transmission will kick down a gear or two anytime I ask for it. In 2023, Volvo's adaptive cruise and lane keep seems about a half generation behind what some competitors are offering. It was leading edge at the time, but hasn't been kept up to date in context to some of the competition, so there is no hands-free mode, and otherwise it works just fine. Dynamically, this is an interesting package, because these Pirelli P0s on these optional 21s do have a tremendous amount of bite, and they do offer a lot of grip, but the suspension really isn't complimentary. I think these 21s are just for aesthetics only, but I think if you do get a cross-country, you really want to go with a smaller diameter wheel with a little bit of a meatier tire with a little bit more of a off-road intention. I think it would be a lot of fun in some deep snow, but yeah, it's a bit of a mismatch between the tire and the suspension. I appreciate the quick turn-in response of these Pirellis, and I appreciate the ultimate grip, but it's a little bit too much for the suspension. This is softly suspended. It's a very comfortable ride, and then because it does have a taller center of gravity, because it is a cross-country V90, there's a fair bit of body roll here as well. It isn't buttoned down like a sports car by any stretch of the imagination. The suspension is soft, there is some secondary motion, and I think that's what you should expect out of a V90 cross country. It is a wagon with a little bit of extra ground clearance with its all-wheel drive. It could go a little bit further off-road. One of the highlights, of course, is the exceptionally powerful braking system. These brakes are fantastic, and on top of that, I love the brake pedal, because I can feel exactly what's going on at those front tires. The brake pedal has tremendous feedback and control and modulation is excellent. Probably should expect that from Volvo because, of course, they are safety first and this brake pedal is excellent. There's not a lot of feel or feedback through the steering wheel. It is an electrically assisted based system, but again, turn and response on these Pirelli P0s is fantastic. There is a decent amount of chassis feel, but again, there's a lot of body roll here, so expect a little bit of extra body motion as well. I do have to say that wheel movement is well controlled with these adaptive dampers. They've done a great job tuning those. Overall, this ride and handling package is definitely tuned very much on the comfort side of the line, so expect a softly suspended, very comfortable ride. And the thing about choosing a big wagon like this over a crossover or an SUV is you do have a lower center of gravity. Yeah, you've got a taller center of gravity compared to the regular V90, but it is significantly lower than a crossover or an SUV, which means you got more responsive dynamics. And that goes for everything in terms of braking, handling, acceleration, overall grip. That lower center of gravity just helps overall dynamics compared to any SUV and crossover. And with the taller ground clearance, you can go probably just as far as any other Volvo SUV or crossover.
How do you spec yours? Well, this is a fairly easy question to answer because they all basically come in the same specification, at least mechanically. Your only choices really are color. This paint is called platinum gray, but really it's brown because who doesn't love a brown wagon? Inside that is amber ventilated Napa leather with, of course, the Orifor crystal shifter. And this is nearly fully equipped with the Bowers & Wilkins and the 21s, as well as the air suspension. As tested, this is a little under $70,000 in the US and a little over $81,000 here in Canada before freight and local taxes. And in terms of specking yours, it's a matter of choosing your colors both inside and out. This one isn't really to my taste, but I'm sure a lot of Longroof lovers will enjoy rocking brown paint on their wagon. Nonetheless, I think there are two options that you need to consider, at least from my perspective, from a driving enthusiast perspective. One is the air suspension, and that helps with utility, especially if you're hauling things, but it also comes paired with adaptive dampers, and I think that is one option you want. What you don't want for a cross country, in my opinion, are these 21s because they come with Pirelli P0s, and with a Volvo cross country that can go a little further off-road, I think a low profile P0 is the last tire we want. My verdict, let's start with fuel consumption because it is interesting. Regular viewers of the show know that I'm not afraid to use my right foot. I do enjoy using the throttle pedal. And despite that, including a lot of city driving, I'm averaging about 24 miles per gallon or about 9.8 liters per 100 kilometers for my Canadian friends. And that is very impressive, at least from my perspective. I would have expected worse given the way that I've been driving it, but these happen to be very efficient. I suppose the mild hybrid system does help a little bit in the city. But otherwise, I'm very impressed with fuel consumption. The only trade-off there is a little bit of that four-cylinder engine noise that we were discussing earlier. But otherwise, this thing, this Volvo V90 Cross Country, is a masterpiece. There's no question that I appreciate the design both inside and out with this V90 Cross Country. And yes, it is on the endangered species list as Volvo transitions to EVs, and they're doing that very, very soon. So this may be your last chance to get something as unique as this V90 Cross Country. It's a stunner. It does a better job day to day than a lot of crossovers and SUVs because it's based on a car with, yes, a little bit more ground clearance, but day-to-day use, that absolutely makes a lot of sense. The dynamics of a car is certainly superior to that of a crossover or an SUV. And on top of that, who doesn't love a gorgeous long roof? This V90 Cross Country is a stunner, and you better get one soon before they're gone forever.
Thanks for hanging out with me today and having a look at this 2023 Volvo V90 Cross Country. Hope you liked this episode, and if you did, you're not new to YouTube, you know what to do. Smash the subscribe button, turn on your notifications, like this video, and as always, sharing is caring. So please share this with your friends, especially on Reddit, because on Reddit, they really need seat reviews for drivers from drivers. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them in the comments below. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you want to support the channel, please hit up our merch store. Links here, links below. Lots of great stuff for driving enthusiasts like us, including our very popular line of Save the Manuals merch. Thanks again for watching. We'll see you again next time. And remember, cars don't understeer by themselves, not even tall Volvo V90s.